He has been called the global face of Indian stand-up comedy. He has performed over 2,000 shows in 25 countries. On the fiercely challenging Last Comic Standing, with over 3,000 comedians from across the world, he was in the top 10. He has been, of course, multiple times awarded South Asia's or Asia's best comedian. But it is when somebody who is insanely funny and who gets to be paid for being insanely funny turns that kind of scathing outward wit into a look at himself and his own profession that you find that a stand-up comic can also turn his creative process into raw art. It is an absolute privilege to have here tonight somebody who calls himself the most famous comedian nobody knows. I'd love to know why the name everybody knows is one that he thinks nobody knows. May we have up on stage Papa CJ.
For starters, let me just say it is wonderful to be introduced onto stage by Payal. As a comedian, I pay a lot of attention to the person who brings me onto stage. Because recently I was in Singapore, and the show I was doing was hosted by a Pakistani stand-up comedian. So this guy got on stage, warmed up the audience, and he invited me onto stage. In that second, I realized I had been a part of history. Yeah, it was the first time I had seen a Pakistani invite an Indian to occupy a piece of land that he was occupying before. Right? Now, have you been to Singapore? Give me a cheer if you've been to Singapore. So you will know this, nothing ever happens in Singapore. Right? The last time I went there, front page of the newspaper, there was a pig on the street. Right? If there is a pig on the street in Singapore, it becomes headline news. In Germany, it becomes a sausage. In America, it becomes the president of the United States of America. Right?
CJ, before we come to everything we have to talk about, I see that we get the suit version of you, but yesterday at the Kerala Lit Fest, people got a slightly different version.
Oh, dude,
of you.
This is so funny. You have to read this guy's comment, all right?
Because there's somebody who says, "Bas Bhagwan, aisa confidence de de, ki itne bade stage pe nikkar aur chappal mein ja sakun."
Listen, in my defense, it was a literature festival on the beach, all right? And frankly speaking, my book is called Naked, so I'm overdressed in that occasion.
So my question was, what does it say about Gurgaon that you're here in a suit tonight?
Cultured people and all, yeah.
Okay, but thanks for being here. And I just wanted to start, Naked, the show that you've been performing to great acclaim, you decided to turn it into a book. Before we actually come to the book...
No, I didn't decide to turn it into a book.
It wrote itself.
No, Amazon came to me. They said, listen, if you turn this into a book, we'll give you free Amazon Prime membership. And as you know, comedians don't get paid any money. We go for international festivals wearing our kachas. So I was like, boss, that's a pretty good deal. I'm going to take it.
There's a couple of stories in the book.
By the way, the Prime membership was more than I got paid for this algebra gig, okay?
True that. But there's a couple of stories in the book that I want to go right into before we come to anything else.
No, let's talk about the fee for this show.
Let's talk about it over a drink, which is roughly our version of Prime membership. Okay.
Dinner nahi milega.
Depends on how we do tonight, CJ. Okay, now you say...
That's what she said. Sorry. I've got
okay,
a drink on stage
I don't know
tonight.
About
I'm
you,
not going to behave
not
myself.
I'm not paid enough for this. Let's...
Why should we do this as an interview? Maybe I will just heckle her throughout the show,
yeah,
right?
But as I just said, I don't know about him, but I'm not being paid enough for this. Let's...
Well, you're going to feel that even more by the end of this.
Okay. I will still come back to what seems like a fascinating story. There are two or three stories, but you say you've performed at gunpoint in South Africa.
Yeah.
You also said, the story I want to come at first, that you've performed in a police station.
Yes.
Now, we do know that the Indian police at this point could use a sense of humor.
Yeah.
So tell me, why did you end up, and how did you end up performing in a police station?
I'm trying to think of whether I mention a red hot topic right now when you mention the Indian police, but maybe I'll leave it for now and come back to it later. The police station. Oh, so very simple. To start with, let me state for the record, I do not endorse drinking and driving. However, I was at a show at the Comedy Store in London. There were five comics. We finished at 3 o'clock in the morning. We were drunk out of our skulls, right? We get into a car, five comedians in the car, one guy driving, drove the wrong way into a one-way. Cops pulled us over, checked the driver. He was way over the limit. Now, the law in the UK says you have to test the driver at the car and then once again at the police station. And if you're above the limit, it's second to murder. So comedian gets put in the police van. Car is put on the side. He said, you know, moral support, we'll come with you. So we get into the van with him. We start driving towards the police station. On the way, we started chatting with the police. Turns out that these cops were from Scotland. So we spoke about the Edinburgh Festival. We said, listen, we're comedians. We're trying to encourage the audience to have a drink. You've got to show them you're having a few yourself. To cut a long story short, we ended up performing for the police in the police station from 4 in the morning till 6 in the morning. They got the driver something to eat. They let him drink water. They let him go to the bathroom. They checked him at 6:30 in the morning. He was below the limit. Sorry to trouble you, sir. That machine must have been faulty. You are free to go. So, yeah. You're clapping for drinking and driving. Shame on you. I should never have worn this suit. You're not worth it.
They're clapping for pulling a fast one over the police.
Which I can understand in Gurgaon. Only place in the country where like you have to have like signs outside the bar saying no arms allowed.
Okay. You were living what would be thought of as the urban middle class dream. You went to Oxford. You joined IBM. You were set for a long, glorious life of boredom, right?
Yeah, but it was still a dry dream.
So, how did you suddenly, one fine day, was it one fine day? How did you become a stand-up comic?
Very simple. I just saw a guy on stage with a drink in one hand and a microphone in the other, and he was just having fun. And that was his job. I thought, boss, this is the most amazing thing in the world. And to be honest, actually, when I was starting to do stand-up, I was deciding between doing stand-up comedy and doing a bartending course. But that bartending course that I looked at, they only taught us how to mix the drinks. They didn't teach us how to juggle the glasses. Right? Let me ask the women here. Give me a cheer if you think it's cool when they juggle the glasses. Yes? Exactly, that's what I thought. I thought if I can't juggle the glasses, I'm never going to get laid. Right? That's why I chose stand-up comedy. And that was 15 years ago. And in the last 15 years, I can't tell you how many times. How many times I wish I had taken that bartending course.
So, okay, I really want to come a little bit to the process of stand-up comedy, which I think all of us who go to watch shows all the time, and we love it, and we have absolutely no idea what it takes, right? Because everybody thinks, oh, I can tell a good joke, and then you think that's what that guy is doing. Tell us what, for example, putting together even just 10 minutes of stand-up material is like, and what does it take to go out and perform it in front of roomfuls of people you don't know?
Basically, it takes a lack of complete self-respect, right? and a thick skin. I mean, it's like moderating a session at algebra, you know? Some days you have a good day, sometimes the speakers are just shit, right? And you're hoping as hell you can save your ass somehow. And then there's a pressure on you to ask the right question so you can get a good answer.
That's the best description that my profession has ever been given.
And sometimes as backup, you have to get an alcohol sponsor so in case the session is terrible, the fuckers. I'm so not going to behave myself today. What was the question again?
I so have no idea what that question was. No, but okay.
What does it take to be a good...
What does it take to put together material... Okay, what does it take, let me put it in a different way. What does it take to be professionally funny instead of being personally funny?
Well, it takes somebody to pay you for your work.
We've been over this.
That's what makes you a professional. No, so see, there's two ways to do it. I think when you start off... So when I started off, it was a science for me, right? I started doing stand-up in London. I did 700 shows in my first 3 years. And I was performing in a country where I hadn't grown up in. I wasn't interested in their politics. I wasn't interested in their sport. So I was doing jokes, right? Specific written material. You know, here's a punchline, here's a punchline. But when I came to India, I've grown up here. I have the same cultural references. So I can do 45 minutes on stage without telling a single pre-written joke because I'm chatting with the audience. So I think there's two sides to it, and it depends on, you can mix it up. Like when I started, I used to have a spreadsheet with jokes. I knew that I do a 90-second bit about a beggar that has 13 punchlines. There's one punchline every 6 seconds, right? I also knew that when you start doing stand-up, you get 5 minutes to perform on stage. Now, in 5 minutes, you don't have the luxury of telling a three-minute story, right? Now, if I do an hour show, I have that luxury. But you've got to get their confidence right at the start. It's like when I walk on the stage, I tell you two jokes off the top, you're laughing, you're like, okay, dude, I've got some confidence, this is not going to be shit. That buys me the time to waffle like this. But I think it's a mix of an art and a science. And also, what you don't realize is comedians plan their shows very scientifically. So you start strong, you end strong. Every joke is rated as strong or weak. And then it's a graph, so it kind of goes strong, weak, strong, weak, strong, weak, and you end on a high. So, you know, the strong stuff will carry the weak stuff. But it's no point me telling you this, because they say that trying to explain humor is like dissecting a frog. Right? It's not funny, and at the end, the frog dies. So, no point sort of wasting it on them.
But tell us a little...
Listen, one person clapping is not enough. If you're going to clap, you better clap properly. Otherwise, I'm going to start reciting poetry. You laughed a little bit too loudly at that one.
Your first few years as a stand-up comic were in the UK, right? Mm. Will you tell us what it took to be... You mentioned the lack of a cultural reference. What did it take to succeed as an outsider in a country that believes it really understands humor?
So I think as an outsider, you have... in many ways, you have an advantage, right? Because you are able to see that country through a lens that they're not able to see themselves. It's like an outsider coming to India. And also the same as an outsider coming to India, you let them get away with some jokes that you wouldn't let a local guy get away with. But for me, I was the only Indian comedian in the UK. So there were some people who would say that, you know, oh, don't talk about being Indian because you'll get stereotyped as the Indian guy. But my thinking was, boss, if I don't talk about the Indian perspective, who will? And I was very conscious to always try and project India in a very positive light, you know, because in a lot of cases, the stereotypes they had of Indians weren't always positive, and they thought that it's cool to go and pick on the corner shop guy. So when I was in a club and somebody heckled me, I remember I was doing a gig in Reading, and there was a table of football hooligans which started heckling me. And I went after the biggest, baddest looking guy, because once you take him down, that table is not going to mess with you. And I'm hoping that the next time they see an Indian guy on the street, they will think twice before saying something racist towards him. Right? I remember this guy. In fact, I'll tell you what I said. This guy was heckling me. He was like, man, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you. I said, my friend, it doesn't matter if I die. I'm Hindu. I'll be reborn. Right? And for all you know, sir, I'll be born as your child. And then I'll be sucking on your wife's titties and you won't even know it's me.
Which actually leads me very...
But let me yes. Sorry, were you saying titties leads you to something? Let's just talk about that. I'm not going to answer the question. Yes, what does it lead you to, Payal?
Mature market humor versus emerging market humor.
No, fuck that. I'm going to answer the previous question. Let me come back to the previous... In terms of what it took to succeed... So when you start by doing a five-minute set. When I started doing stand-up in London, to get a five-minute set in a comedy club, there were 1,000 other new comedians who wanted to get that spot. So that's how competitive it was. I managed to get 250 gigs in my first 10 months, right? No, it's basically groveling, okay? A lot of it was groveling and hard work, but I would wake up. So I did about 400 shows outside London, about 300 shows in London. I would wake up every day at about 10 o'clock in the morning, cook one meal for myself at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I would get into some comedian's car at 4 to drive to some city in the UK. I would get there. I was nervous. I wouldn't eat. I was doing between 5 and 10 minutes max after having driven 4 hours one way. Sometimes 300 people had shown up. Sometimes it was a university gig and 5 people had shown up. We would finish at night. I would get dropped off in the outskirts of London at 2 in the morning. I would pay the driver my share of petrol. I wasn't getting paid for any of these shows. I would change 3 different buses, sometimes waiting for 45 minutes in cold London winter. I would get home at about 4:30 or 5 in the morning. I did this every single day for an entire year. At the end of that year, I had no money, no friends, no relationships, and no life. But every single comedy promoter in the country knew my name. So that's how you kind of start.
And I think that was really at the heart of my question, which is it seems physically grueling, brutal work to become the comedian that nobody knows.
Yeah, but you know, there was a big advantage to that. I just want to point out the huge upside of being in that car. I've spent over 2,000 hours in cars driving towards shows in the UK. But those 2,000 hours have been spent with two other comedians in that car who have been doing comedy for between 10 and 20 years. I have seen them prepare their shows. I have seen them analyze their shows afterwards. I have begged them to please watch my set and give me feedback, right? That is invaluable. That is comedy university right there. I mean, today, if you get to spend, you know, 10 minutes with somebody who's been doing it for 20 years longer than you have, you consider that a valuable experience. I got 2,000 hours. I mean, I wouldn't change that for anything, yeah?
Who are your comedy heroes?
Okay, we'll leave the politicians out for now.
Let's not.
So for me, a lot of my heroes are people I've seen perform live, right? I mean, one of the questions I get asked, and the reason I say I'm the most famous comedian that nobody knows, is I don't put a lot of videos out there, right? There's not a lot of content on YouTube, and I don't have specials out there. In many ways, I believe that that stand-up comedy is like sex, right? It's best enjoyed live, not in front of a screen, right? So if you're watching it on a screen, you're surfing comedy porn, basically. But for me, a lot of my heroes are the people I've seen perform live. Right? When you go into a room and let's say the performer before you didn't exactly give them a good show, right? And you have to take a room that is really tough and turn it around. That is a completely different art form to a three-minute clip that you see on the internet, which is edited just to show you the fun bits. So for me, my heroes are the people I've seen work live and turn around tough gigs. There are gigs I've gone and struggled, and then a guy who's been doing it for 15 years longer than me, or a girl, just gets up there and boom, one line, they've got them. For me, that's where the magic is.
So give us an example of like a really tough room. What would you call a tough room?
What would I call a tough room? Not this one. Oh, it was about 45 minutes ago. Oh, sorry. So I'm kidding. I'm not kidding. A tough room. Now, a room like this is a great room, right? Because you have come with the intention to listen, right? Music can run in the background. For comedy, people need to shut up and listen. Sometimes you'll go for a corporate gig where people have come to attend an awards night or hang with their buddies. They want to have a drink and have a good time. As a comedian, you're forced upon them. You know, they're being told, shut up and listen to this guy. That can be a tough gig. Because then you've got to get into the audience, break up that conversation, draw them in, and then perform. Often you don't get to do jokes. You're just engaging with them just so you can pull them in. But in a sense, I believe that any performance is largely the management of energy. You know? I mean, it's like having a PhD in group psychology. You get a sense for the pulse of the audience, what makes them tick, what doesn't. Even when you're picking on somebody, you'll sense when you got to sort of draw back or go further. It's a lot of it is just being in the moment and understanding how to work that crowd.
So how different was writing or is writing comedy from writing a book, which this is your first?
Oh, writing a book is much easier, yeah? Much easier. I mean, with due respect to the authors out there, because listen, in stand-up comedy, we are judged every 15 seconds. Every 15 seconds, if you guys are not laughing, I'm failing, right? As an author, I sit in the comfort of my room and I write some stuff which may be funny in my head or good in my head, I don't know, right? As a stand-up comedian, I'm getting in front of different audiences every night. You could have had a good day at work, you could have had a bad day at work, you can be different age groups, different backgrounds, different nationalities, different cultural references. No matter who is in the room, I've got to make them laugh and entertain them. Far harder job. But that being said, I think being an author has certain upsides because in stand-up, we remove every single extra word so we can get to the punchline as soon as possible. Right? Because often it's in an environment where people don't have the patience, they've had a few drinks. With the medium of writing, it allows you that narrative freedom of adding layers of depth and layers of emotion, which you may not have the luxury of in stand-up. So that can end up in a far richer experience for the audience in the room.
So when you...
Hang on, pause for a second. Did you like that answer? Clap, huh? What is this? Listen, I'm not an author. I'm basically a comedian. So I'm used to response. If you guys stop clapping, then I'll be like,
I've heard of demanding audiences. This is the first time I've seen a demanding speaker.
She got on stage and said, I've done this 2,000 times in 25 countries, right? If they're not laughing, they have failed. I'll take off the suit. Sorry, what was that, sir? I think he's talking to you. My friend, I'm not getting paid to do stand-up here, so I'm literally going to give you the bottom of the barrel star. I'm kidding.
Yeah. But when you move back to India, right, yeah. There was virtually no comedy scene.
By the way, I'm going to go and pick on that guy later, the guy who apparently has a fetish for lace.
When you move back, as I said, there was virtually... Will you tell us...
Are all your jokes laced, or should I ask the wife? I'm kidding, sorry.
Do you want, if we can do that first?
Can I get one more large whiskey with with Coke? We're talking about the whiskey, right?
What was the comedy scene like, or was there a comedy scene in India when you decided to move back? Why did you decide to move back?
I decided to move back because for me, my family is the most important thing in the world. And I was sitting over there and thinking, what am I doing here when everybody who matters to me is back home? So that was my decision to move back. And also, I am very desi. You know, when I walk on the road in my own country, I think, mere baap ka raaj hai, right? So for me, I just wanted to be home. And I'm not the kind of guy who comes to a place and thinks, oh, nobody's doing stand-up, so there's no market. I'm like, fuck that, I'll create it, you know. So this is 2008, I moved back. I did my first two tours then. And early 2009, I started off the English language circuit in Delhi. And but it was interesting, right? Because I met an aunt and she's like, beta, tum kya karte ho? I said, auntie, main comedian hoon, main joke sunata hoon. She said, beta, joke to main bhi sunati hoon. Tum kaam kya karte ho? And the thing is, comedians don't get any respect, okay? Even today's day and age, I'll do a good gig, I'll walk off stage, somebody will say, boss, you are a rock star today. I challenge you to go to a rock star after a show and say, dude, you are a comedian today. Thappad milenge bas. So yeah, but...
But what did it take to be to set up a stand-up scene, which now seems to be quite the dominant kind of... It's a big entertainment genre in the country today.
I don't think it's... I think it just took... I'll tell you what it took on my part. My part was to create a supporting environment. Because stand-up comedy is not an easy thing to do. It is very difficult. Now, if you get a comic, there's nothing worse than trying to make people laugh and getting 5 minutes of silence, right? There's a laugh of recognition. No, because see, the thing with stand-up is, you know, people talk about entrepreneurship and how important failure is. We learn nothing from a good show. You just walk off stage thinking, boss, I'm the king. In a bad show, like I said, we get feedback every 15 seconds. If you don't have the depth of material or the expertise to adapt on the spot, Ganpat, thank you, sir. Easy, Tiger. So not all of us speak early. Bottom of the barrel sexual innuendo is what you'll get, okay? So there's nothing harder than trying to make people laugh and getting 5 minutes of silence. So when you're on your drive back home, you have to ask yourself, if I'm ever again in the same situation, in a similar country with a similar audience of a similar background, what can I do differently so I don't look like a fool? So actually, failure is the only way for us to get better. We have to keep doing different gigs in front of different audiences so we learn how to work that room. Now, when I launch the circuit here, nobody's going to be good instantly. But the audience that comes into that room is watching Seinfeld and Comedy Central, right? So you're walking in expecting that, whereas this guy just got off his couch and said, boss, my stand-up comedian banega, right? So not only do you have to manage the expectations in the room, you've got to make sure that the audience understands what it takes and make sure that it is supportive. I mean, I've been in one situation where an audience member heckled a new comedian to the point that I could see his spirit die on stage. He literally bailed out midway through and said, "Mere se nahi hota," and he went and sat down. I could not stop myself. I got on stage, took the microphone, caught that guy. I told him, "Fucker, you come up and do it." He came up, he came for 2 minutes, he struggled his ass off, right? Got booed off, went and sat down. That same comedian got on stage, performed again, and he killed it in that room, right? So there are two things that we need. Not only do we need that somebody to support the comics, but we also need audiences that are supportive. The problem is we still live in a country where everybody wants a pass for an event, right? Either I'm so important that I need to be on a VIP guest list, right? But I will not buy a ticket. And if you guys don't buy tickets, then the next generation is also going to have to want to be doctor and lawyer and engineer because their parents are not going to be able to say, "Beta, tu jaake stand-up comedian ban ja, kyunki tu paise ban sakte hai," right? So if you guys have ever asked for a free pass or a free ticket, just stop doing it because it means you will not be able to see these shows for longer.
You.
Sorry. Haan, bolo, so bolo. For what? Which show? This is not a show, sir. This is a discussion. Did you read the thing when you came here? Or did you get a free pass and just land up? Huh? You paid for your pass, so you pay for shit without knowing what's going on. You must be traveling to Thailand quite often, my friend. Okay, I won't go there.
But you referenced being in other countries and performing, and I wanted to know if you've ever performed in front of an audience that doesn't speak English.
Oh, yes, I have. But I'll tell you about this story. It's quite an interesting story. There are two different stories. I'll tell you the one that's more fun. I was doing a festival in Singapore called Spikes. Anyone work in advertising? So it's a large advertising festival, 2,000 people from all over Asia, and it's a little bit like performing for the United Nations, right? Because half of these guys speak English, and the other half don't. So the guys who don't speak English, they have headsets. And right at the back are 6 transparent booths with translators, right? Now, as a comedian, it's really interesting, right? Because you crack a joke, first the English-speaking people will laugh. Then there's a pause, and the other fuckers laugh, right? When it's a really funny joke, these guys are laughing their heads off. You can see the anticipation on the faces of the other guys. Now, my remit was that the language had to be clean, but the content could be about anything at all. So at one point, I cracked a joke that had the word blowjob in it. And when I cracked this joke, I looked at the translators. Right? This is what happened. Blowjob. Because clearly between the 6 of them, they didn't have a single word that could translate that word. So they had to describe the entire activity. You think that was funny? There was one guy on the right side of the stage. He was doing sign language for the deaf. Mil gaya aapko joke, sir. Thank you.
when
bolo bahar aana padta hai milne ke liye.
Okay, while we are at it, the South Africa.
There's a lag. Some of them like get the jokes by satellite. Must be like a Vodafone connection. It takes time.
Okay, and in fact, I will come back to the question I was going to ask. But I want to ask, what to you is the power of humor? What can only humor do that nothing else does?
Are you guys feeling better than you were feeling half an hour ago? That's the power of humor, yeah?
And
No, wait for the applause to die down, then you can. No, I think this humor is wonderful in any situation, yeah? They say that comedy is tragedy plus time. As comedians, we are able to look at difficult situations in our life. And even when we are going through them, like if I'm going through something really difficult, while I'm going through this, I'm thinking to myself, this is really tough, but it's going to be hilarious on stage in 6 months, right? That allows you to do two things. Not only does it make your life much better, but when you go on stage and you're able to talk about your pain in a way that is funny, other people in the room who have been through similar situations are able to look at that and say, boss, if this guy can laugh at it, why can I not do that? And I think that is superbly powerful.
I also think that that's actually, I did want to briefly come to your book, Naked, which came out of that show. And that's actually a remarkable quality of that book, which is you turn that rather sharp eye on yourself, and there's a sense, anybody reading it says, that guy could be me, right? How he's responding is different.
So this is the bit where my publisher and I actually, we argued on this, because there was a particular, or parts of the book, in fact, almost one chapter, where she said, I don't want you to write this. I mean, what's so special about this? Everybody's been through it. And my argument was that is exactly why it needs to be there. Because I'm not the kind of performer who gets on stage and says, you know what it's like when you're getting bored and you buy a 50 lakh rupee car? No, they don't know what it's like, you know. But everybody knows what it's like to go through struggles in life, whether it's financial, whether it's job, whether it's relationships. So for me, when they read the book, not only do I want them to enjoy my story, I want them to be able to look back on their own stories and reflect on that. And I think that is a different experience, which is very important to me as a performer. It might be different for different people, but for me, and what happened, I mean, if the book is terrible, it's entirely my fault, because I did not let my editor do anything at all. And I think the greatest credit I can give her is that she allowed me to have the freedom to do it entirely in my voice. So, I mean, if you've met me, if you go out there, just read two pages in the book, from page 5 to page 7, right? It will give you a feel for the tone of the book. It's like I'm sitting next to you at a bar and telling you a story. It's for really educated people, it might be a bit simple, but I think it's an easy read, and I hope people enjoy it.
And yet, you did say the power of humor is that you can make people feel better than they were feeling 30 minutes ago. What happens when you have to go on stage and you're not feeling very good yourself?
It doesn't matter at all. I have done shows with. Oh, thank God! For a second, I thought they were showing people Fab India ads so that they could be more entertained. I've seen that happen in the past. I've done shows with. Should I pull back now? I think maybe I should. I've done shows with 104 temperature. I've done shows with dengue. I have done a show where I had pneumonia. I've actually got on stage and told the audience I'm having serious chest pains. If I collapse at any point, it is not a joke. Please help me. And just like you, they laughed. Right? But yeah, I mean, you've got a job to do, boss. And it doesn't matter how I'm feeling, but as a professional, there are 500 people in the room who are expecting me to laugh. I mean, if it's algebra, it's a lower turnout. But so as a professional, I got to get there and do what I got to do, yeah.
You also do corporate training as well as corporate shows. How is that different from talking to an audience where they're entirely different? A corporate audience should be more homogenous.
Well, we spoke about this a little bit before in terms of people who've come with the intention to listen. I prefer non-homogeneous audiences because you can work, you know, one group against each other. But a corporate gig is very dangerous for stand-up comedy, because today in an entire year, I will get maybe one show through an event manager, right? An event manager gets an inquiry, he will call the client and say, Papa CJ is not available, because he wants to book the guy on whom he can make the largest margin. Today, your average comedian is a 25-year-old male who performs in a pub in front of other 25-year-old males, right? He gets booked for this gig, he gets on stage, he does not have the breadth of material or the depth of expertise to hold that audience's attention, right? Suddenly, you've got a 45-year-old guy in the audience, average age, or a CEO. This guy gets on stage and starts doing jokes about Facebook and masturbation with the physical gestures, right? Halfway through, he's pulled off stage. That guy in the room, the client, does not say, I'm never going to hire him again. He says, I'm never going to hire a stand-up comedian again, because that is what they believe stand-up comedy is. And that is very harmful for our industry, right? Says the one stand-up comedian in the audience. No, but the other thing that also happens is, you know, often people will say, oh, comedians, they're vulgar. Have you heard this before? Yeah. Why does a comedian crack a joke? Because he wants the audience to laugh, right? The only reason comedians keep cracking those jokes is because you guys keep laughing at them. So my argument is that you are vulgar. Right? Now I know what you're thinking, oh, not algebra, we don't, I mean, really, even you put on a suit to come here. But But you see, what happens is, in a smaller country, for example, as an audience evolves, they force the comedians to evolve and raise their game. In our country, if an audience evolves, another audience comes and takes their place. So often that pressure isn't there on the comic to necessarily raise their game. So the onus is, in many times, on the audiences to find that balance between being supportive and yet telling them, dude, come on, we need better.
You know, we spoke of course, comedy is making people feel better, but other than individually, at a societal level, what is it that comedy can do in a society? Because, I mean, around the world, for example, the great stand-up comics now are almost the new journalists. They're calling out politics with a sharp, funny eye every night on television and in live shows. Do you think, A, humor is fundamentally political? Is there a reason you stay away from politics? There's a bunch of questions in here, but largely talking about the role of comedy in a society other than making people feel good. Okay.
So humor doesn't have to be political. And I think each comedian finds their own voice. Some people are more political, some people are less. What you spoke about in the US, that is happening in our country now because journalists have stopped being journalists and but I also think it is not up to people, like often people will say, why are you not talking about it? Or why is so-and-so not talking about it? I think each person has to do what is authentic to them, right? I mean, has anyone here ever conducted a job interview? Just cheer if you have, right? Now, when somebody's lying, can you tell? Instantly, right? Now, there are a lot of people who will say, oh, this is what is fashionable to say now, so I'm just going to throw my comments about it so I look cool. If you're not authentic, if you're not well-informed, and you're just doing it to get the eyeballs, people are going to see through that. So yes, humor is like a rubber sword. You can make a point without drawing any blood, and it is an extremely powerful tool to do that. But if you are not authentic and well-informed, it's better you don't do that because it's just not genuine. Yeah? I mean, I get called for these TV debates. Once a week, somebody calls me. Right? So once I decided to go, I don't know if you remember this, there was a debate where there was a judge, I think in Rajasthan or somewhere, who had said that peahens get pregnant from the tears of the peacock. You remember this? Right? So they were having this TV debate and I was called. Right? And they said, Papa CJ, what do you have to say about this? So I said, sir, I have 2 points to make. Firstly, on this panel, you say that you're talking about how judges should be appointed in the country. Right? You have 2 high court judges, you have three Supreme Court lawyers, and you have a stand-up comedian. What the fuck am I doing here? Right? And if you're not talking about how judges should be appointed, and if you're actually talking about, you know, peahens and peacocks and whether they get pregnant by the tears of the peacock on the 9 p.m. national news, then how are you any less stupid than the person who made that comment? Then, of course, you're like, no, but you are a concerned citizen. I said, I'm not that concerned a citizen. Right? So I think it's very important. Yes, it's a hugely powerful tool, but it needs to be authentic in terms of how you use it. Sure. So for me, by nature, I have never been so interested in politics or religion. But for me, I use humor in a different way. So for example, I do something called the Happiness Project. Now, 2 years ago, I said, for 2 weeks in a row, I will do free shows for any charity across the country. I did 7 shows in 6 cities. We raised 45 lakhs for 10 charities in a period of 10 days, right? Year before last, I said for an entire month, anybody who's got a family member and who's been unwell for a long time, I will come to your home, I will come to your hospital room, whether it's 2 people, 5 people, I will perform for you, right? I have been to the room of a lady who's 80 plus, has a leg amputated, goes for dialysis 3 times a week, and I have performed for just 6 people in her bedroom. I have seen the family members of cancer patients cry because they haven't seen that family member laugh like that in years. I remember after I did that lady's house, the lady was 80 plus. When I finished, I said, Auntie, I lied. I said, this show is not for free. What I want from you as payment is every morning, I want to receive a laughing photograph of yours. 3 days later, her son sends me a message saying, boss, you have increased her lifespan. Now when I send you her photograph, she's 80 plus, She says, now when I send you her photograph, she wants to look at it first to make sure she's looking nice. Right? Right? Boss, where do you get that job satisfaction in any job? So I don't think it is fair to necessarily point fingers saying this is what you should do. Or, you know? Each person affects change in the way that they know best. And I believe you should do it in the way that is most authentic to you. You know? No. That being said, I did kind of take part in the protest and I got into trouble. Yesterday I was catching a flight, right, from Bombay to Delhi. I got to the airport and the security guy said, sir, can you give me or show me a boarding pass? I said, sorry boss, hum kagaz nahi dikhayenge.
I wanted to talk a little bit about comedy and censorship or self-censorship. And self-censorship, really, because often in a live show, there may not be any censorship. Is there something or anything that you think is sacred that should not be joked about?
No, I don't think there is anything that should not be joked about. I think it's very individual for people, right? People take decisions based on their value system and sometimes the value system of the people in the room. For some people, it is more important for them to make their point and get that across than necessarily to please the people who are in the room. For some people, no. So for me, I don't mind teasing people. I don't mind embarrassing people. Right? I don't mind a single person walking out thinking, boss, usne to meri baja di. But I never want to be hurtful. Right? And I think there's a big difference in that, which often many people don't know. When I say many people, I mean performers. So for me, I will draw that line based on what my own value system is, which is different for different people. But if I can see somebody genuinely getting upset, I will immediately pull back because that's not my intention. Right? People come in the room to be entertained and feel better. Why would I want to have somebody? That being said, our point of view does not change depending on who's in the room. How we deliver it might. You know. So for example, in the US, the US is a McDonald's of comedy. Right? It's very, here's a joke. It's very snappy. In the UK, it's like fine dining. It's a part of their culture. You know, you can tell a 3-minute story and they will wait for a punchline at the end. Southeast Asia has very polite audiences. You know, so you literally, after a joke, either they like crowd interaction where you get in their faces, or you literally have to say, that was funny, clap fuckers, right? I mean, I'm wondering to think whether this audience is from Southeast Asia. Well done, sir, on cue, the rest of them did not get that. It would be inappropriate to say spread the clap because that might be... Well done to those of you who got that. India, it's a little bit different because all over the world, like you said, stand-up is a very grassroots art form. Anti-establishment, anti-elite, almost a form of protest. In India, more often than not, English language stand-up comedy is performed for the elite. So you're just coming at it from a slightly different angle. That being said, I mean, there's lots of people who say, oh, Indians don't have a sense of humor, yeah, as a country. I'm sorry, boss, I disagree. I have made a living doing stand-up comedy in this country for the last 12 years because Indians do have a sense of humor and they can laugh at themselves. Compliment to you, you're clapping. Huh, shabash. What is the ghanti for? How much time left?
5 odd minutes or as long as we want.
Up to them, boss.
But I wanted to say, you've performed with a host of international comics as well. What is it like, or will you tell us a particular performer performance that really stood out for you? And how difficult is it to bounce humor off another person?
How difficult is it? Elaborate, when you say how difficult is it to bounce?
So for example, two people on stage, how spontaneous is it or how rehearsed is it when you're performing with another comic together?
I think it depends entirely on the personality of the person you're with. So for example, you got on this stage with some questions you had in mind. Yeah. And that kind of went to shit at the start because...
Yeah. That's exactly where it stayed.
Right? So I think a lot of... I'm so bad. This probably explains why I'm single. I think a lot of it depends on the two people on stage. There is no fixed... I mean, our profession has so many variables. There is nothing that is fixed at any point, whether it's working with another comic, with the kind of audience in the room, the kind of mood they're in. I mean, there's just far too many variables. There is no You can't go to a school for stand-up. You just have to do it and do it and do it and do it.
Are comedians born or made?
What do you think the answer is, the madam? A mix of both? Yeah, I think some people are naturally funny and some people have to work at it. For me, when I started, I had to work at it. Now it comes a lot more naturally. But I genuinely think that anybody has the ability to be a good comedian. I mean, I've always said, if you see a comic and you think he's shit or terrible, do not say anything negative to discourage that person, because I have seen people who I think are terrible. Right? Guys who have come to me like 10 years ago in this country who said, CJ, I chucked up my job, I'm going to be doing stand-up full-time. And in my head, I'm thinking, boss, what the hell is wrong with you? Have you ever seen a video of yourself on stage? Right? But I have said, awesome, dude, anything I can do to support, go for it, etc. And that person has gone and proven me wrong and how. Right? I will tell you a story. I was doing I'll give you a name and I'll give you an example of a show. I used to host shows in a place called Cuba at Malchamag, yeah. Right? I remember we had a show, there were maybe 220 odd people in. And there was a young comic who got on stage to perform in Hindi. He was supposed to do 10 minutes. In 5 minutes, he walked off stage because nobody laughed. He had the worst gig of his life. And I'm pretty sure at that point, he must have thought, I'm never going to do stand-up comedy again. That guy goes by the name of Zakir Khan. And he fills up stadiums today. So I genuinely believe you should never discourage a guy. And the other big problem I have in our country is that the attitude towards everything seems to be elitist. Right? Why do you have to be successful as an English stand-up comedian? Right? 3 days ago, I had an interview with a newspaper which says that, you know, when are our comedians going to be successful on a global stage? Why do they have to go to a global stage? We have 1.3 billion people in this country. So, you know, I remember when the Comedy Store opened up in Bombay, I had a comic who went there, had a terrible weekend doing shows there, and he came back and he said, I had the most terrible time. They said, you only have to perform in English because we are the Comedy Store, this and that. I told him, boss, the next time you go there, na, you just do your thing the way you know how to do it. You do it in Hindi if that's what works for you. I don't know if you've heard of this comic called Jiveshu Aluwalia. Jiveshu went back to the Comedy Store. He performed in Hindi. He destroyed that room. There was not a single comedian who could follow him after that. And they kept booking him, right? So we need to, you see, what is stand-up comedy is a beautiful profession, right? We operate in a profession that has no rules, no boundaries, no guidelines, no social norms. It's an incredible journey of self-discovery because you're forced to look inwards and ask yourself, how do I feel about things? What is important to me? And initially when you start, so I'll give you some jokes here because that's what you want. Initially when you start, you'll go for the easy joke, right? The one, because you want the confidence, you can make people laugh. So the kind of joke I would crack is that, you know, I live in Delhi and I don't understand the language they speak in Bombay. You know, like we call it bread, they call it pao. We call it pyaz, they call it kanda. We call it a servant quarter, they call it a 2 BHK. Easy joke, I know you're going to laugh. Then we do observational comedy, right? So the kind of joke I've done in the past is, I was flying, remember Kingfisher, the airline? Anyone here who wears glasses and has flown Kingfisher business class? Anybody at all? You have, madam? You have, sir? What happened on the flight? If you were wearing glasses, you flew Kingfisher business class, what would happen? They would clean your glasses. Exactly, sir, I didn't know this. I'm sitting on this business class seat. This gorgeous air hostess walks up towards me with a tissue in her hand. Yeah. She said, sir, would you like me to clean your spectacles? Exactly. Cabin pressure, I did not hear the word spectacles. I don't know what happened to you, sir. But it's pretty embarrassing when you're standing in business class with your pants around your ankle saying, give me the Kingfisher experience. Right? So observational comedy. Then what happens is we want to be seen as cool and edgy, right? So we will start using bad language. We will pick on positions of authority. I mean, even I know that in the last half an hour or 40 minutes I've been on stage, there were a few times where I threw in the F word. I could see my mom cringing because she's going to come to me afterwards and said, you know, CJ, you didn't need to say that in this audience. Right? And now she's laughing because she knows that's what she would have said. Right? But we do that because we want to be seen edgy and breaking the norm, you know. But the problem with shock comedy is, after the first three times, you're like, okay, boss, I've heard you say BC on stage three times. We've got it. Now say something funny. Right? Often people don't get past that. Then we like to do jokes that make us feel intelligent. Right? So I'll give you an example of a joke. Now, I grew up in Calcutta. Anyone been to Calcutta? Yeah. So, I mean, if you want to know what Calcutta was like in the early 1980s, you can go there tomorrow. I learned how to drive in Calcutta, boss. I remember taking driving lessons in London. This instructor asks me, he says, you Indians, why don't you drive in a straight line? I said, boss, I am from Calcutta. In England, you drive on the left of the road. In Calcutta, we drive on what is left of the road. But we had a Bengali president, Pranab Mukherjee. Any fans of Pranab da? Give me a cheer. Quite a few people. Okay. Now, give me a cheer if you think that Abdul Kalam was the coolest president ever. I agree with you completely, but let me tell you why. Because he was president of India the same time that George Bush was the president of the United States of America. He could have walked into the US, gone up to anyone, and said, you know what, your president is a dumb fuck. If anyone turned around and said, who do you think you are, rocket scientist? See, now that's the kind of joke that makes you feel intelligent because people pause and they're like, haan yaar, ye toh rocket scientist. Right? You see, the fun joke is when there's a pause and then they get it. Like, it's like when I went to the US, I had a beard. This officer looks at my passport, looks at my beard. He says, you know what, you Indians, you're a mistake. In fact, India is a mistake. I said, come on, officer. As an American, you should be grateful to us. He said, why? I said, well, because when Christopher Columbus discovered America, he was looking for India. So to be perfectly honest, you are the bloody mistake. Technically, that makes America the bastard child of India. See, now... Thank you. Do you want to end immediately?
No.
Okay, public demand, boss. Dekho, madam, main naked karta hu. Agar marna hai to ghanti mat maro, CT maro. Don't worry, whenever you want to end, we'll end.
We're good.
So eventually what happens is, you're forced to look inwards, right? And talk about things that mean something to you. And you get to a point where you don't even care about what the audience thinks. You do what you think is funny, you talk about the values that mean something to you, and your audience finds you. The people who don't like you will weed themselves out automatically. Because if your audience changes all the time, if you keep changing your point of view or your sense of humor to try and please people in the room, what do you stand for? What is your voice, right? So, if you think of any of the famous comics, whether it's George Carlin, Chris Rock, Russell Peters, whoever it is, they're not going to change what they do because somebody else is in the room. So, I think it's a liberating journey because when you get to that point, you are able to apply that to your life, right? And in your life, you are able to say, and it's there with the book, it's there in my shows, you're able to say, this is who I am, this is my truth. If it works for you, fine. If it doesn't work for you, also fine. I respect that. That is incredibly liberating. I mean, today there are parents in this room, all of us who've grown up. How many of us have chased a definition of success or happiness that was defined by somebody else? Right? You could be living in Magnolias, earning X amount of crores a year, right? But be miserable. Because when you grow up, you were told, beta, tum school karo, college karo, master's degree karo, shadi karo, do bache paida karo, then you are settled, right? And it is a joy to be able to see people who are able to break that mold, right? I mean, today there's a theater group here. Vanessa is here, Gagan is here. I don't know if are you familiar with their group and their play? Right? I cannot tell you the amount of respect I have for them. Right? Because once a month they will have a reading in their room, and people who are passionate about theater will be assigned their roles. They will come there, they will start on time, and they are pursuing their passion. Right? No, I mean, nobody's saying, "Aye, aye, nautanki karta yega." Right? So I think it's very important to define what success means to you, what happiness means to you, because your definition will be different to your brother, your sister, your parents, your spouse, everybody else. And if you can't do that, then you're never going to be happy. And I think that is very important for us to do as human beings. And stand-up comedy is something that allows us to get there.
What, is there a particular, have there been particular landmarks in the journey for you till now as a stand-up comic that you feel were defining moments? And going forward, what do you see yourself doing? Do you see yourself doing exactly what you do now? Or is there something else that you see for yourself in the future?
I'm terrible at planning. I'm not the kind of guy who really has a plan. But
you got an MBA.
I did get an MBA, but let's be honest, Oxford University is not putting me on the brochure. Right? They're not saying, come spend £40,000 on an Oxford MBA, you can be a stand-up comedian one day. I don't have a plan, but I'm the kind of guy who's always open to possibilities, always open to having a conversation and exploring things. This book wasn't part of the plan, it's happened. There's an audio book that's probably going to come. It may get adapted to screen. Who knows? I mean, what are you doing tonight?
Talking to you.
I mean, as two people who aren't getting paid for this, we might as well go and drown our sorrows in Johnny Walker and whoever else is sponsoring them.
And we still do need to know the South Africa at gunpoint story before we end.
We've got to a real high right now. Don't you want to kind of leave them there? And,
Is there a bigger high for a stand-up comic than being made to perform at gunpoint?
Yeah, getting paid to perform at gunpoint. Okay, I'll quickly fly through this one. I don't think it's the right one for this time. So I was doing a show in South Africa. I was touring in 2007. I had been doing stand-up comedy for barely 2.5 years. I was invited to headline a festival there. The deal is we get paid in advance, then we fly. My money hadn't come. I thought, the organizer said, listen, no problem, we'll sort it out. I said, fine. I got on a plane. I flew another comedian friend of mine from New York down called Vidur Kapoor. We both get there, meet the organizer. I said, you know, where's the money? He said, I'll bring it tomorrow before the show. Fine, no problem. We were in a seedy, shady suburb of Johannesburg called Linesia. Linz is what they call it. We get taken to this flat, which is, everything is pink. You know, I don't know if it was because you know, my fellow comedian was gay, but everything was pink. Like the walls, the bed sheets, everything. Anyway, next day he comes to the show, and so I said, where's the money? He said, no, I'll give it to you later. I said, listen, the contract is very simple. Just go to a cash machine and bring it. So he said, no, we'll do it later. So I said, boss, I'm not coming. He pulls out a gun. He said, no, you are coming. Fine, no choice. I mean, I didn't tell the other guy. He would like run away instantly. So we go to this mall. So I'm thinking, okay, there's a theater in this mall. Get inside, no theater. Maybe it's in a restaurant. We go to the basement, and we go to an underground parking lot. There is a makeshift stage on an underground parking lot. There are 500 chairs. People have got their own cumbles and are sitting over there. Anyway, so I get on stage, and I'm closing the show. I'm on stage. There's 500 people in front of me. There's a guy at the back with a gun in his hand. So can I perform to save my life? Yes, I can. Right. Then from there, we were going to go to Cape Town and then to Durban. Now, the Cape Town shows got canceled because these guys didn't promote it. But I told Vidur, come, let's go to Cape Town. We'll roam around. Durban, we were doing two shows in Sibaya Casino, 1,000-seater. Both the shows were sold out. We get to Cape Town, and I give this organizer a call. I said, boss, we are not coming. Until you don't send the money, we are not coming to Durban. He didn't know where we were staying. I was staying with a friend. So he sent some money across, enough for me to settle this guy off. Now, he had come on my account. I said, boss, I want him to be sorted. Now we had a decision to take. Now my logic, now Vidur did not know this story about the gun and stuff. Now my logic was this. I've been doing stand-up comedy for 2.5 years. I'm performing in 2,000-seater auditoriums, right? International show, I'm headlining a festival. They're not going to shoot me before the show. Right? So I'm like, boss, chalte hain yaar. I had a taxi waiting for me backstage at the end of the second show. I finished my show, ran backstage, got into the cab, went to the airport, bought a fresh ticket, and flew out of there. So that's the gunpoint story. So can I perform to save my life? Yes, I can.
Okay, I think pretty much all we have time for, but since we did ask what, and you spoke of comics working to get better, how does an audience become a better audience?
Just drink more alcohol before the show. Can we do some audience Q&A just in case they have some questions? If you
sure,
guys want.
Sure. If there are a couple of questions, we'll try and get a mic to you.
Yeah.
Can we have a few house lights?
Can you put the house lights up? Just tell me your name and then ask the question.
My name is Aniruddha. Very simple question. What do you think about this whole burgeoning comic scene in India? It's just crazy over the last 3 to 5 years, right?
I think it's fantastic. Yeah, the more the merrier. The beautiful part about our country is that we have so many different countries within our country, and we are able to have comedians who will cater to them. There was a guy called Praveen Kumar, a comedian from Bangalore, who started doing his stand-up comedy only in English. And he didn't receive one-tenth the success that he's receiving now when he's decided, you know what, I'm going to do only Tamil. So the beauty is that there is somebody for everyone. You and I may not like Kapil Sharma, but Kapil Sharma gets on there and he entertains millions. So I wouldn't put anything down or put any comedian down because art is entirely subjective. And if somebody's doing it, means there's probably an audience for them, even if you're not that person.
No, I'm so happy you gave those two examples. But I mean, that's kind of what I meant, which is, it's just gone crazy, right? I mean, the number of people trying to perform and number of people trying to make it, and maybe volume is the answer. But I was just curious.
Eventually what will happen is with any scene, the guys who are not talented or not good enough will. I mean, when you start off, there's a lot of crap, there's a lot of good stuff, which is going to happen with our scene as well. Eventually, as an audience, you will say, you know what, I'm not going to pay for this shit again. So it'll get better. Yeah. Any more?
I saw a hand somewhere else.
There's a lady at the back
right
there.
At the back. We'll get a
we'll
mic,
get a
to,
mic
you.
To you.
Just give us a minute. Yeah. Oh, okay.
Also I had another friend whose name was Anirudh. By the way, he had 4 children. Can you imagine? The parents called him Anirudh and he had 4 children. He's about to have a second next week. Are we sure it's his? And he's here. Huh? You'd like to think so. Well, my friend, if she's at home and you're here all this while, think again. Okay.
So there was a question there, but there's a question. I think the mic got there first.
Yeah. There's a lady. Oh, yeah, the lady over there. Go ahead.
I'm Sarika. I didn't get the answer again, like, you know, from a comedian to a author, a writer.
Yeah.
Why? Like, how it clicked to write a book?
I answered this question right at the start. Amazon Prime, free membership, yaad nahi hai?
Nahi, wo right answer nahi hai. Nahi hai. Dekho, wo right answer nahi hai.
See, boss, I have to...
Wo bahut hasane wali answer hai, but in depth.
देखो मैडम मेरे पेरेंट्स यहाँ फर्स्ट टेबल पे बैठे हैं राइट बड़ी मेहनत करके पैसे वैसे कमा के जमा करके बच्चे को ऑक्सफोर्ड भेजा MBA करने के लिए कुछ तो उनको लगे कि मेरे बेटे ने किताब लिखा है बेसिकली ईगो ट्रिप बॉस व्हाई डू यू राइट अ बुक देयर इज नो मनी इन इट ईदर देयर इज अ स्टोरी यू डाइंग टू टेल आई एम ऑलरेडी टेलिंग माई स्टोरीज ऑन स्टेज विद स्टैंड अप कॉमेडी इट्स इंस्टेंट ग्रेटिफिकेशन आई विल राइट अ जोक इन द आफ्टरनून कम अप हियर टेल यू कागज नहीं दिखाएंगे यू विल लाफ राइट ऑथर वेरी बोरिंग बॉस And who wants, sorry, with all due respect to the authors and all, this author stuff is damn boring. I go to all these, I've been going to all these literature festivals right now. It is intellectual masturbation, boss. Mere ko kuch samajh mein nahi aata hai. As far as I'm concerned, if you're an author, you should sit in a room and write your book. Why are you coming and talking to people? You should be a speaker then. Right?
Well, that point of view seems to explain why Shashi Tharoor wants to be a stand-up comic.
He's bloody good, okay? Whatever you say about the guy, he is damn good. And he may have done Comic Stand right now. The first time he was on a stand-up comedy stage was when he came for one of my shows and I got him on stage to tell a joke and he was bloody good.
He is. So, there is no question. There was another question from the lady at the back. That's right.
Hi, my name is Lena. I just wanted to share with you, like many years ago, I don't know which year it was, we were performing at the Epicenter in Gurgaon.
Yeah.
So my kids were younger then. I think the age limit was 16 or something for the show.
Yeah.
So we took our kids for the show saying, you know, you must experience what a comedy show is and, you know, thought it would be for the kids.
Yeah.
And it was really funny because we, my husband and I and our friends, we found it so funny. We were dying to laugh, but then we could see our kids cringing. And then you're like, should we laugh at this joke now? Because maybe it's not, but it was really cute and it was fun because it was fun to see you, of course, and then to see our kids cringing in the background like, oh God, this is funny, but we can't laugh in front of mom and dad.
See, I always do this at a show. Whenever this happens, I used to say this very often, that if you're sitting with your parents or your children, you should always change seats. Right? It's because like when you're sitting at home and you're watching a film and one of those scenes comes, right, and nobody knows where to look, but everybody's enjoying it. Right? It's exactly like that. And I love playing on the generation gap. Like nowadays with all this social media, I mean, this is a hashtag generation, right? Sir, your time, no tags, right? Just hash. Right? And I don't know what the age group was, but nowadays, boss, kids know everything at such a young age. Like, I mean, in our days, when we were in school, we used to, we had pornographic magazines, right? Nowadays, they're surfing it on their phone. Like, sir, for you, it must have been like hieroglyphics. But nowadays, these guys are surfing it on their phone, right? For us, in the 90s, we didn't have that luxury. Like, I remember when the internet had just come, you couldn't download a video. At best, you got a photograph. Anyone in their 40s? 40s, give me a cheer. Yeah. So you know what it's like. At best, you could download a photograph, and I still remember how they used to download. Right? First, you had the hair. Then you had the eyes. Then you had the nose. By this point, 18 minutes have gone. Our man is already getting warmed up. Right? From the side, you can hear that modem going, kree-koo, kree-koo. Till today, when I hear the sound of a modem, I get turned on.
We have, I think we're pretty much done. There is one question that we will, the final question we'll take, and then the rest over a drink.
Okay, I just want to bring in a very different perspective here, Charlie Chaplin. Okay, he was a comedian who had the ability to put up a show where three sections of audience would have different reactions. The kids would laugh, the guys were a bit older would just about get sobered up, and probably the elder ones were crying. This was the ability of a comedian to address three sections of audiences with the same show, which was supposedly a comedy, but was various parts to various people. How do you sense that comedy in its genre is something that can go across sections of people and therefore should not be excluded to say that this is only for adults or this is only for this, because the way it comes across, it addresses various audiences with the same piece at the same time and the interpretations are different.
So let me answer that question. Two things. One, at one level, as comedians, we are slightly limited due to the medium. Because unlike Charlie Chaplin or Mr. Bean, for example, we have to use a language. Now, the second way using a language, we've already excluded people who don't speak that language. And a lot of humor comes out of context. So if you've been to a comedy club in New York, you will go to the basement at the Comedy Cellar, you will see these audiences laughing their heads off, and you might not understand a single joke. Because the thing with comedy is, the more local it is, the funnier it is. So me telling you that 2 BHK joke about Delhi and Bombay is hilarious for you guys, but it doesn't travel very well. Right? It's not going to work in London or New York. The more topical humor is, right? If I say Kagaz Nahi Dikhayenge right now, it's funny for you. If I say it in a year's time, well, hopefully it will not be relevant by then. Right? So we are slightly limited by the medium. That being said, what I love about my audiences, it's different for different comedians, right? In my audiences, I have people who come in who are 16 years old, or like that lady's children. I don't know how old were your kids when they came? They were 16. So I have 16-year-olds who come, and I also have 80-year-olds who come. And it's the same with the book, that, or any piece of art, that different people will take different things away from it, exactly as you described. That is not something I can manufacture or control. For me, it is to be true to the piece that I'm performing based on what I think works best or make sense to me. Then it is up to the audience to decide what they want to take away from that piece of art, whether it is looking at a painting and saying, this is what works for me or what doesn't. So whenever somebody asks me, what should I take away from your book, I never give them an answer because it's different for different people. So I think what is important for the performer, the artist, is to be true to him or herself. And then it is up to you as the audience to take away what you can from it.
Yeah. CJ, thank you for running away with this evening and for taking us with you. Thanks so much. CJ's book is available outside. With pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.